This conference will now be recorded.
Centralized facilities that are existing. We have about 2,280 tons of available processing capacity, and about 1,130 tons is actually being processed. So we have about a 49% efficiency there. In the case of decentralized, we are showing a slightly higher percentage because the numbers are smaller. We have about 413 tons of install capacity, and we are having about 293 tons being recovered. That's about 87%. So in all, if you see the total material recovery that we are actually carrying forward today is about 35%. And the waste to landfill is about 2,700 tons of the estimated 4,123 tons, which is about 65%. So as you can see, a bulk of our waste is actually going to the landfill, and overall the the figures are not very good. Close out this data part, in terms of actual capacity, we have a 40% capacity shortfall. Now, how have we arrived at the actual estimate of what is required for the city? It's a guess. It's from approximations, and again from some collation of thumb rule figures that we have with us. So which means that we have a 40% capacity shortfall. And the sad thing is that of the 60% that is actually installed, we have a 48% idle capacity. So all in all, we're not doing too well. Now, the question comes that why is this so, given that Bangalore has actually been a front runner in this whole SWM story and has actually pioneered a whole bunch of these processes and thoughts that have been in the SWM has now been adopted by the Swachh Bharat and got into the rules. You know, we've really pioneered a whole bunch of work here. And I think almost half the citizenry is in some sense involved in solid waste management because
we lost you.
They have to self all of this. Why is the show pathetic? Simple answer to that I have realized is why vibrant, active, that these are what we would bucket in the concept of what we call as practices, best practices. So while we know how to do optimal segregation at source, how a particular process of composting should be done, how do we run set up a dry waste collection center, we know the hows of everything, but we don't know how to actually make it happen on a scale. So we are amazing on a pilot, we are amazing on an innovative level, we are amazing on a standalone. But as a city, when we then needed to actually scale up and have it run across the city, we find that we're failing, we are not actually doing well. So I like to equate this to, two sides of a coin. You take the one side of the coin is the best practices for SWM, and the other side of the coin is the governance. Many of us like to believe that the reason why the SWM has not progressed anywhere in the city is because of actually very poor governance that has not matched up to the requirement of what SWM needs. And this is what we're going to be talking about in the, where I'll kind of highlight a few of the points which are important in bringing in this good governance into the SWM. The starting point of governance is a very simple thing that every one of us who's active in the field of solid waste management all the time keeps coming in contact with, which is payments. You all are aware that payments don't get done on time. There is invariably a delay, and the people who are working on the field don't get their salaries. And now that we have the Paurakarmikas in the direct pay system, there's been some streamlining of payment, but mostly all payments get delayed. Even yesterday I was having a conversation with one of the practitioners who was giving me a horror story about the amount of outstanding that is there for about 3 to 4 months, and it runs into crores. How are we expecting that these people on the ground are going to deploy their vehicles, are going to deploy their labor without their monthly payments coming in? So this has been one of the fundamental problems of not being able to get efficiency on the ground, because we are not even able to pay people on time. And why we are not able to pay is really the reason why we have to get into governance in terms of structures. Is the money not there, and is the fund not getting deployed? Or is there a problem in which the way in which the money is actually getting paid? So these are all issues that have to get tracked later on. Now, in terms of the allocation of funds to the SWM, you all know that we have the SWM CESS, and this is we are doing a collection of about 16, 17 crores out of the projected 60 crores that the city is projecting as SWM CESS. This is nowhere close to what the city actually needs. We are spending about 1,000 crores. So fundamentally, there is a way, you know, something wrong in the way in which this whole thing has been even structured. So if there is such a high shortfall in CESS, the thinking for some time has been under the SWM rules 2016 that we are allowed to collect user fees. Now, this needs political will, it needs intent, it needs a way of approaching the subject. And to understand how to go about user fees, the city first has to know who its users are and have a classification of who these users are. So while we have a broad understanding of that there are households, there are bulk generators, it's only lately that the you know, city has started recognizing that the bulk generators have to actually be broken up into two parts, which is the commercial and the non-commercial bulk generators. And the commercial generators have a big role to play in the way in which efficiently SWM is managed. Now, if user fees have to be charged, obviously there, you know, some effort has been made now. I don't know how many of you have looked at the draft bylaws which came out a couple of months ago, and there is the Schedule 6 where there has been an attempt for the first time to actually identify the kind of users and to peg down a user fee. Now, when we come down to understanding what a user fee should be, one has to know what is the true cost of operations, and therefore one decides whether the city should subsidize 60%, 70%, 80%, but this understanding is not there. So A, we don't know, you know, the classification of users is not clear. B, what is the true cost of operations, and therefore how will you identify what is the user fee that has to be done? Some effort has been made, but we are not entirely clear if the user fee that has been identified is the true cost, because it has never been quantified so far and the data is completely insufficient. So with the data on hand, some effort has been made to quantify the user fee. But having done all of that, we are not very clear whether it will actually get passed in council, and this will go through the requirement of seeing it through and actually coming out in the open, and user fees will then start getting implemented. If it does, it's great, because it will help towards the collection, and it will help towards you know, bringing in the required accountability and in spending more money that the city needs to. Then comes the question of budgets. It has taken very long for everyone involved in SWM to even understand what is the kind of budgeting that is needed. What does it actually cost to set up an infrastructure? What does it cost to do it on scale? What does it cost to do it for multiple processes? So, you know, each one of these things has never been quantified before. So earlier, the budgets that were being made were very ad hoc and were very thumb rule. And it was more with comfort of the numbers. Okay, this looks too high, let's just cap it at this, and then we'll worry about how we can manage the rest later. But if the requirement is 1,000 crores, and if we do not get that 1,000 crores, there's no way in which the city is going to run, given the size and given the number of people. So even in terms of the budget, this is a very important part of governance, and very little is known about the total cost that is needed to put the budget together. There has been some effort made through the Suvarna Bengaluru allocation of about 999 crores. It's on a three-year tranche where on an annual basis, they are required to spend about 300 odd crores, and the buckets are very clearly defined. But the way in which this deployment is going to be done, who is the nodal agency, and the actual rollout of funds hasn't actually started. So while some effort has been made to actually pinning the money down, the movement of these funds into the ground has not started, because a lot of preparatory work has to happen before the funds are actually put into the field. So this is the one bucket that I've spoken to you about, the various components of the finance part of it, and all of which needs executive decisions, political decisions, where they have to do a lot of planning to enable it to be compatible with what is the requirement of SWM on the ground. Then comes the next bucket, which is about policy. A big part of governance is to do with policy. Now, a lot of the best practices that have shown or validated that processes work, yes, it's possible for us to scale it up. To actually scale it up, the only way in which it can be scaled up is if there is a bylaw or if there is a policy. The last policy that the state of Karnataka had was in 2004. It's now 16 years and we've not had any changes, minor or major, happening to that policy ever. Some attempt was made because of the pressure of the NGT and the High Court to start this work in 2018. The 2016 rules actually required that all states should bring out their policy within 6 months of the rules coming out, but somehow nobody ever met that deadline. With the pressure coming on from the court and the NGT, we've still seen about three iterations to the policy, and we're still in the process of collecting feedback. And to date, 2 years after the process has started, we still don't have a policy on hand. We do not know when the gazetted notification is going to be out. Now, based on this policy, the next level is that a BBMP would then be required to draft the bylaws based on what the government has put out as its policy. They are then required to take these points and then implement or draft a strategy statement document or a bylaw. So the BBMP has, of course, on its own gone ahead and drafted the bylaws, but it in some sense may or may not be in consonance with what the policy is unless the two come out together. And you know, it's a $1 million guess as to whenever these bylaws and policies, which are now in draft mode, are ever going to get notified. And then it becomes some kind of a framework for SWM to start happening. So as of now, we still don't have that overarching framework, which is a big, big problem, because every single mayor or commissioner or whoever that comes in these important significant positions then is doing a test run or a dry run or pilots and testing out what works and what doesn't work based on their understanding of what is done. We cannot afford to have this kind of discretionary or personality driven interventions happening in SWM for the city. It has to be something that is locked down. And all that is available is that every single officer or whoever comes into these various posts then just delivers based on milestone requirements or service level benchmarks or whatever that is identified for the city. But we are very, very far away from that situation right now. Then comes the third bucket, which is a really important one where governance is involved, and that's to do with the contractual arrangements. This has been the bane of the entire SWM process in the city. We have been able to have good positive interventions in many areas. The one area where it always lets us down is this inability to, bell the cat on the fixing the contractual arrangements. As of now, we are again working on a very ad hoc work order system. The work order system is nothing other than a agreement to hire from a contractor who supplies the vehicles and his labor, that he has no statutory binding and there is no way we can actually make anyone accountable in the system. So neither the official is accountable, nor is the contractor who's supplying the vehicles and the labor accountable. And the last, if you look at the history of contracts, the system of contracts started in the year 2000. We had one renewal which happened in the year 2007. Subsequently, it got, on a yearly basis, just by, it was an automatic renewal and it just went on status quo till about 2011. When the KMC Amendment Act came out in 2012, there was a big push to bring out new contracts. Some effort was made. It lasted for exactly 6 months. Those of you who remember the BBG contracts were the first formal contracts which came into the city after a very long time. And they were either allowed to lapse or a lot of things was literally almost sabotaged, and all of them were closed out very quickly by 2013 Jan. From 2013 Jan to date, in this last 7 years, there have been three attempts to bring out contenders, and we have yet not seen a formal process coming into place. As we know now, while we are at this present point in time, even the last effort that was made, which took 1.5 years in the making, has now, may have been cancelled by the standing committee, and we don't know what is the situation of the new contracts. So the city is now operating without a contractual system. And when we don't have contracts, apart from the accountability, the way in which the payments are made, the way in which the payments are quantified, there is no ability to pull down, bring in the GPS system, which has been a long-standing ask, so that we are able to track the vehicles on the ground. All of this becomes a difficult thing to do, and accountability has been close to impossible. Coming to the technological interventions that are needed in the area of governance, again, needed in the area of SWM, it needs good governance, and it needs someone to stand tall and say, we are going to fix accountability by bringing in and planning for smart control rooms. There was a small effort made to set up a control room where some allocation of a crore to set up a temporary control room was initiated. It was shot down. Now we are locked into a 23 crore budget setting up of under the Smart City initiative, set up a control room, but that's a 3-year project. And we don't know at the end of the year to have a smart control room. So all of these are very actively in the realm of governance, which only officials, the government, and the council can enable and bring about. But the impact of not having all these on the ground is tremendous. Then we come to the zero discharge ward, or the processing and the disposal. Now, for a long time, there has been a lot of talk about zero to landfill, the need to enable each of the wards so that they are able to stand alone and set up their processing and disposal facilities, so there is no long distance hauling. But the biggest roadblock that has come in setting up these processes, and like many of us who are working on the ground can endorse, it's the inability to find land or to get permissions to find land in the ward or in the constituency for processing. The land is always available for every other thing, but excepting for SWM processing. It's become close to impossible for us to find land, and even those which are identified are very badly designed and in the wrong place, making it close to impossible for us to have proper SWM projects. So long as we don't have the will to find land and to identify and pin down land for SWM purposes, we are never going to be able to get past this long distance contract and the need to send it to the landfill, because we are not identifying land for processing within the ward. So this is a nexus, or this is a arrangement of convenience, where the reason cited is always lack of land. And if there is land, the money is never deployed on time, and survey numbers are not put out. I mean, we have a whole bunch of various kinds of reasons why areas are not identified for SWM processes. So if this is not possible, the concept of a zero discharge ward then just remains on paper. Because one of the fundamental requirements is the first step is the land, and then is the budgets for it. We know that some amount of budgets have been allocated for the broad purpose of setting up infrastructure, but the next project management requirement of actually enabling that to get rolled out on the ground is not available within the capabilities of the current BBMP. They have no way of creating a project management cell which will be able to roll out. Just think back of which was the last project you ever saw which was rolled out in a time-bound manner and actually started delivering or commissioned at the required time. The only example we have is the setting up of the SWM plants, but that was done under the pressure of the courts. And that is the only example we have where actually the government and the BBMP went through, but this was done without even the people in the BBMP knowing. It was done from the KUIDFC sitting outside the BBMP. So this brings us to a big question of what are the capabilities of the BBMP in terms of actually setting up these processing and disposal plants. Once that is done, we have the few that have been set up with a lot of pressure and a lot of influence and a lot of other hard work from volunteers and practitioners has seen that payments don't get made to the vendors who are setting up these plants. The process, there is no time-bound process, and it makes a mockery of the willingness of private businesses to come forward and actually get into a PPP with the BBMP or the government. And it extends the requirement of trust too far, that they have to actually work on a close to pro bono basis to show that their processing facilities work. And this is not, I mean, this is inconceivable how we can expect to set up infrastructure within the city. We are expecting all businesses to come forward and set it up and then do it almost close to pro bono, because the BBMP or the government is not able to find a process to deploy the funds and pay people on time. And those of which have been running, again, the O&M is a big story. The operations and maintenance, which is the monthly payment that has to be made, is a nightmare. We can show you examples of process units, which are small units, which are running close to 8 years or 10 years, the OWCs and the biogas units, which have been running only because of the commitment of the people who are running these to show that these are possible and to somehow not allow it to close down. The BBMP to date does not have an in-house process to provide for a monthly operations and maintenance to any of these small processing facilities. So that is the fourth bucket. The fifth bucket and the last one, which I'll be talking about, is the a big one and a big part of the governance, is the organization of the SWM cell. Today, the SWM cell is organized as a department within the BBMP, and the tenure of the people who come in is short. They are not the right kind of people. We have civil engineers and mechanical engineers who are thrust into the job of managing solid waste. By the time they come up, the learning curve is very, very steep. And by the time they come up that learning curve, they choose to move out, and we've lost the investment of time and effort made into training that person. And we've seen waves and waves of health inspectors and assistant executive engineers and all of them who choose not to stay in SWM because there are it's a difficult job and there is nothing to pin them down. So we do not have today a dedicated set of expertise or specialists within the BBMP who we can depend upon. And the institutional memory is only with the practitioners who have been engaging with the various commissioners or the various mayors or the various officers on the ground to say, okay, the last time we did this, why don't you try this? This was tried before, why don't you try that? So they have become the institutional memory, and there is no in-house organizational structure. So there have been a lot of thoughts around, is this organization of the SWM cell really the best? And what can be done to improve it? And how can we empower the SWM cell in a better way? So that there is more autonomy and more ability for them to deliver better. But these are all big questions and needs a lot of debate and have to be put down. There have been thoughts and conversations, a lot of much more thought and conversation has to go into making these happen. I'm heading the council. So with that, I've kind of run through the various trigger points which are really important for governance and the impact of each one of these, which is it's having on the poor performance of SWM that we're seeing in the city. And I'll be happy to take questions.
Hello, I am Subbu Hegde here. Can you hear me?
Yeah, sure.
You mentioned in the beginning, the processing capacity or garbage collection and disposal capacity of the BBMP is short by 40%, right?
Yeah.
So when you say capacity, does it talk about only the infrastructure of the BBMP, or are you also considering the the processing done by the RWAs? For example, there are large number of housing complexes who process their own waste.
We have only attempted to capture the data of the BBMP and and some amount of very large private capacity that is existing in the city today.
Okay, so BBMP does not have an idea how much is this capacity with the RWAs or the other institutions, right?
Yes, it does not have. There is no documented process and survey done. From the small efforts that have been made to submit figures for the survey, we know that the figures are not much. They don't contribute too much into this give or take 3-4%. It's not much.
Okay, but is it? I mean, say like I'm in a residential layout of 500 families, and we process our waste entirely ourselves and reuse it. I'm sure like this, there are at least 200 communities of the layout, and similarly the apartment complexes.
Yes, sir. So that's what I'm trying to explain to you, that we have a thumb rule quantification that has been done of these 1,500 odd apartment units across the city which are managing their own waste, but it's a drop in the ocean. It's not it okay. Doesn't contribute much in terms of the percentage. That's why I said it give or take 3-4% of the 40%, but actually the bulk of it is coming from the commercial guys and from the house, what we call as the nomenclature that is used, which is the household, that is the 30 lakh households that the BBMP recognizes for its door-to-door collection.
Okay. In fact, in the budget, I'm looking at the budget of 2018-19, which I could catch hold of. There is one item in the budget called Promote Institute Composting. Some 50 lakhs have been earmarked for this. Is it meant for RWAs to process? Is there some kind of a promotion?
So this is the problem with the budgets. We have seen over and over again that they have put heads of account and they have brought in the budgets. But to date, we know that it is never spent for the purpose for which the budget was taken.
Okay.
So promote institute management, we have never seen a branding exercise from the BBMP, and we have not seen any effort made by them to do handholding like Kerala has done. They have set up an amazing network of solution providers and handholding facilities. The BBMP has never done that. So while they have budgeted a lot of these figures under various heads, it's very rarely used for those same heads.
Okay, got it. Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you for your presentation. This is Sairam. So when we talk about SWM, are we more bothered about the organic waste or both organic as well as
Okay, so let me just explain to you what SWM actually encompasses. Solid waste management encompasses the various following things. It first encompasses the municipal actual solid waste management, which is the wet, dry, the six categories that all of us easily recognize, which is the wet waste, the dry waste, the hazardous waste, and the sanitary waste, the garden waste, and the horticulture waste. This is one bucket of solid waste. Then there is another bucket, which is the construction and debris waste. Then there is a third bucket, which is the e-waste, which is not so much under municipal solid waste management. To some extent it is, because there is some element of e-waste that is coming into the solid waste streams. Then we have the fecal sludge management, which is now actually a big one, because a lot of it's not just about Bangalore, and if you take it across, there are various cities which do not have UGDs, and they have only a pit system where they need to actually have dredging, which is done, and then the material is removed and actually taken outside and dumped. So fecal sludge management is a very big one. Then we have the legacy waste management, which is the waste which is lying in the landfills, which have never been treated for years and years and years, and these have to be taken care of. And then there is the animal waste, which is an entirely slaughterhouse waste management. So when we talk of solid waste management for the city, it's this 7 or 8 big, very large buckets which are required to be managed by the solid waste management, by the authorities. But when a layman talks, invariably it ends up being the smaller wet waste, dry waste, all of that. But all encompassing, these are, when you look at governance, all policy, all draft, all bylaws, all budgets have to take care of all of these streams of waste.
Thank you.
Hello, this is Gautam.
Yeah, sure.
BBMP has ward-wise budgets for OPEX, or is it a general budget which they have as a operational budget for solid waste management?
Sorry, can you please repeat that?
Do they have a ward-wise budget, or it's a single budget for the whole Bangalore?
Oh, it's a single budget. Oh, we haven't come down to the level of actually deploying. So they always do a divide by 198 and then do a budget.
Okay, that's the problem then, because each ward has different sizes. Yeah, so there is a shortage. And as you said, some of the changes.
Sorry, can you repeat that?
Whenever the commissioner changes, the change in the commissioner, the priority changes, because I have worked on a smart city project. Every 6 months, we had the MD being replaced and the priority changes.
Yeah, which is what I was saying, that we have worked with close to 9 commissioners so far. We have worked with close to 10 mayors, and I don't know how many chief secretaries and how many additional chief secretaries. It has been a nightmare for us to have to constantly keep, in some sense, bringing them up the learning curve, make them understand what SWM is all about. And that is because they do not have an institutional document like the policy or the bylaw which they can fall back on. It's only hearsay. It's what you say, what I say, what their officers say, and that no city can ever work like that.
Bangalore can have BWSB for water supply and sewage. Why not one more entity having managing only the solid waste? Is it possible to look at it?
Are you part of the BNMP? Are you part of the party?
Just joined as a one.
We hope that you will take that thought and conversation forward in your party and actually debate it. And there is a lot of merit in it. And we really hope that you will talk about it in detail. And we'd be very happy to share the details.
Hello.
Yeah.
Hello. Hello, Sandhya.
Yeah.
I'm Geeta, and I stay in Bangalore, and we have a hotel actually. I made it fully like zero waste. So as we had a lot of problem in taking out the garbage problem. So as in the whole Bangalore, from so many years, we have been hearing like the major problem is, other than roads, potholes, all the things, the real, real problem is from every house managing the waste dusting. And there are so many areas like us, we have set up a unit, we made a lot of house independent in managing their solid waste, and lot of, I think, different parts in Maleshwaram and in many areas, they have their own units, and lot of people are coming forward. I know they are managing their waste management and doing lot of gardening and other things and reusing that.
Yes,
so
what
I wanted to know is, like, why can't, where is the gap, like, when we have so much idea, we have a people, then why don't they set up and unit ward wise and identify people who can have that, So they can make one or two prototypes and make a good prototype in one or two places, then they can implement the whole thing. Where is the gap it is coming? Like, please go ahead.
So this is exactly what I've been explaining in the last half an hour, that despite the fact that we have amazing set of prototypes, pilots, best practices, people have shown creativity, a lot of innovation on the ground. Why is it that at city level, this has not got implemented? And the reasons for that are pretty much the reasons that I listed out so far. It's either an organizational problem, or it's a financial problem, or it's an expertise problem, or it's simply a lack of political will. So it's a combination of all these problems, and not because we don't know how to deal with solid waste. So this is a very important thing that everyone has to understand. We know what is to be, everybody knows what is to be done to manage solid waste. But what is not happening is the scaling up of that and a law or a rule which will get passed on, like there is a helmet rule and every single person is expected to wear a helmet. In the same way, there are 10 different things that everybody has to do that can only get implemented if you bring it in through the KMC Amendment Act, or if you bring it in through a BBMP bylaw, or you have a state policy. To date, none of these are there. So there are a number of listed out, which is the reason why we are not seeing good waste management practices in the city.
Okay, I agree. Then how we can go as a BBMP, how we can fill this gap, and what all the areas we can work on to take it forward?
Yeah, so I have listed what you can do for improving financial structuring. So there are a lot of restructuring and reforms that have to be brought in. Each one of these is a separate area, and it needs a certain amount of thought and a roadmap to put it together within the government, within the BBMP. It can only be done by the government and by the BBMP, which is the BBMP includes the bureaucrats and the council, who are the elected members. The combination of both make the BBMP. So very often what we have seen is that the bureaucrats do have a sense for what is to be done, but the elected representatives who are sitting in the council very often are not supporting that. Now, unless the two of them move together, we are not going to see a movement forward in SW.
Okay, thank you.
Srikanth, why don't you ask your question?
Just a minute. Srikanth, let me have one more question. Gautam Kamathya.
Okay.
One question. Whether BBMP has thought about putting up energy generation plants where the contract is given to the contractor, including collecting the waste and generating energy from which he can operate, then the operational cost can be covered by him.
So when you say energy, so this is the thing. When we implement, this is the reason why a policy and bylaw is so important. Because what you are saying, Mr. Gautam, is again your personal opinion of how waste can be managed. But there are very clear frameworks on whether is it sustainable for us to have energy generation? Does it work? Is it cost effective? So there is a lot of work, there is a lot of data, there is a lot of regulatory requirements that have to be complied with. And so to do that, for you to take a decision as a person in that executive thing, you would need to have a set of guidelines which say, okay, energy is fifth or seventh in the list of processing facilities that I'm supposed to set up. So there has to be a list that comes and says, this is the preferred list or prioritization of the way in which the processing facilities, the first composting, the second one biomethanation, or the third is... So that kind of support has to be given to the people who are making the decisions. That is number one, what technology to use. The second one is, comes the financial arrangement or the contractual arrangement of, are you going to go into a 100% BBMP owned, or are you going to go into a part BBMP and a part private owned. So these are all financial arrangements which have to be studied on a case-to-case merit. So there is no one single answer for that. It's a very complex thing, and it's on a case-to-case basis and has to be, you know, in line with the various guidelines that are there, either in the rules or in the bylaws or in the policy.
Okay, thank you.
Hi,
hello.
Sandhya.
Yeah.
Can you hear me? This is Meenakshi. So
yeah.
I think you need to tell Gautam that our waste is not energy efficient, that our waste is whatever 50% water, and therefore you know, the waste to energy plants from the Okhla plant that we saw, all of them have failed, and therefore there is, you know, that's really the last priority. We have so many better methods of working our garbage through.
Yeah, so while so the point that I'm trying to make is actually that these cannot be, again, private conversations or debates that we have. There has to be a policy that the city should adopt, saying every large city, you know, will then say that if I have X number of tons, if I have 4,000 tons of waste, this is my preferred technology methods. And if that is not laid down, it keeps leaving it open for debates, which is not possible. So I think since we're talking about governance, the point that I'm trying to make here is we have to now come, we know enough about various technologies like Dr. Meenakshi talked about. We know enough about the merits and demerits of all the technologies for there to be a guiding document existing with the government and the BBMP, so that whoever comes into the chair is then supported to make the right decision based on the policy or the bylaws which the government has adopted. And today, since that is not there, it becomes a talking point and an argument point, which is, you know, your view versus my view, and that cannot happen going forward.
Thank you, Sandhya.
Srikant's connection is weak, but this is the question he wants to ask. In many cases where garbage is segregated, the contract... Yeah, you can see
okay,
me
so
now?
I can see.
Am I audible now?
Yes.
Yeah, Srikant, I see your comment. And so you asked where garbage is segregated, contractors pick up the waste and probably dump it in a landfill.
Probably I'll give a context to it. The initial part of your conversation was around the very poor levels of segregation, despite the laws having been in place for more than 8 years now. So clearly there's something going wrong at the individual household level. And if you get into the system of penalization at the individual household level, it will probably end up becoming some kind of a license raj where it creates scope for more harassment and bribe seeking at the individual level. So is there a way by which we can work on an incentive structure and a penalization structure for the contractors where they are incentivized for picking up segregated waste and are penalized for picking up mixed waste? Is that a system that we can move towards at all? What's your view on that?
Yeah, sure. Are you able to hear?
Yeah.
Okay. So to answer your question, this is exactly the two points that I raised. So we believe that segregation at source is weak because door-to-door collection is weak. The door-to-door collection is weak because there is no contractual system. The contractual system is that's therefore the arrangement where you can choose to either penalize or choose to incentivize. It is a contractual arrangement that you're going to do where, and if you look at all the various contracts that have, the tender contracts that have been drawn up, it takes a combination of both. It takes a little bit of incentivizing and a little bit of penalizing in the various clauses. And when it became too tight, the contractors pushed back and said, we cannot adhere or we cannot comply with your tender conditions. You're making it too tough for us. And there have been pushback from the contractors and they have taken it to court. So this is the fine line. So while we may theorize that this is the optimal way in which a contract should be drafted, finally, issuing the contract on the ground and making our existing contractors adhere to it is another ball game, which falls squarely in the realm of good governance. It comes from multiple other things. You have to pay on time. You have to prove that as BBMP, if you're having 200 wards that you are servicing, that all payments will go on time. And you know, there are multiple requirements that have to be there. So when we say that segregation at source is weak, the segregation at source is weak only for one part because the household does not segregate. For the remaining four parts is because the system has failed it in many, many ways.
Yeah, thank you, Sandhya, for that. I guess governance is at the, or misgovernance is very much at the root of all the problems that we are facing. Interestingly, not just for garbage collection or these garbage contracts, I guess it's true for most of the other contracts. I don't know whether you've been able to engage with BBMP on that front, but when we go through all the contracts that are awarded, whether it's for public works or for garbage collection or for any of the other maintenance works that happen at the ward level, the standard trend and pattern that we are seeing is that between the time the work gets completed to the time that these contractors get paid, it's a time frame of anywhere between 1.5 to 2 years, which means clearly there is absolutely no incentive for the good contractors to come in and do any kind of good work. So is there any engagement that you have had with BBMP on why that's happening? Is it deliberately done that way to prevent the good people from coming in? Or is there a way by which it can actually be streamlined in a little bit better form? What is really the bottleneck there?
So it's in two parts, your question. Whether we have worked with the BBMP on the contracts, our entire work in some part has been, I mean, right through for the last 12 years, I think, has been on reading every single word of that contract and tweaking it and making sure that it needs to read in the way in which we can get good, effective SWM. But that is the one part. That is the process part. So we have been very, very successful in building in the clauses for good process. Where it goes out of our hand and falls squarely in the lap of the political, the council and the standing committee and all of them who have to do the decisions, is the part where the financial compliances. Now here, in the past, it was very loose, and lately we are finding that it's become a little stricter. But even then, there is an unwillingness to actually, like I told you, the pushback has been, oh, avarella apply madalari tumba strict madidre avarella yaru barode illa ee contract ella who will do it. So for that, the single small intervention that we have been suggesting to the BBMP is, where is the problem in building an in-house capacity? It simply does away at one shot the requirement for a contract. If you were to build as BBMP the in-house capacity of owning your own vehicles, having your own people, at one shot, the entire problems of managing this contract, the entire problems of having to satisfy everybody goes away, which is what successful cities like Indore have done. So while Indore is touted or showcased for the part that they have achieved 100% segregation, nobody talks about the fact that they are actually a completely in-house managed setup. They have no contractors in the city. So we have been talking for the longest time that BBMP should be able to develop its own slowly over a period of time, every year, make sure that you put aside a budget for procuring your own vehicles and your own people. But guess what? I mean, I don't have to elaborate to you why this has not moved forward and why there's such a big pushback on it. To date, we have no BBMP in-house capacity. thanks to the whole effort that was done on the Paurakarmikas, that went through, but we've not had, you know, any ability to push this in-house ownership of the BBMP. If we did that, this entire tangle of contracts would go away. And I think all of you who are, you know, in the space of the party, is something very valuable for you to keep in mind. Why are we not developing an in-house capacity?
I think, Sandhya, you probably answered it yourself. You did mention that you didn't want to elaborate it further. It actually becomes a political issue, which is something that we need to look at it from a practical perspective. And for the benefit of everybody, it's a very open secret that most of the contractors, if not all of them, are either the relatives or the cronies of the corporators come MLAs. So clearly, there is absolutely no interest or incentive for them to move away from this current system of contracts, which keeps benefiting them all the time. So we believe that the only way to break the nexus is at some point, probably have a different set of corporators come in, which is what we are fighting for. But at the fundamental level, is there any interest or is there any push at least coming from the state government? How long are they going to just bury their head in the sand and say that, you know, we're just going to be at the whims and fancies of these MLAs and the other corporators who run the system and let the city, you know, keep going to the dogs all the time?
Are you expecting me to answer that? I mean, you know the answer to that. Unless you bring up a counter-political dialogue where you have, another set of political people who are willing to talk about this in the open, the citizens are doing it day in and day out. Every single practitioner has been shouting hoarse from the rooftops. But that's not enough. The court has been doing it. Now what is needed is for some amount of political voice also to be, an alternative voice to come up on this.
Yeah, absolutely. At least from a BNP perspective, we definitely commit that we want to fight for these precise set of issues. And that's one of the key reasons why we came into being in the first place. So that's something that we will definitely do from our perspective. And I don't have any more questions.
Madam, I have a question. This is Vijay Rao from Uttaradi.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, Madam, I was just contemplating, I don't know the scope available. This particular SWM, is there a possibility, instead of talking to various contractors of various, as Srikant was saying, cronies or representatives of the existing corporators or the, the politicians, is there a way that the entire thing is outsourced to one private agency? Let me be a little wild in thinking. Like, for example, one big group, something like Reliance, it came across my mind, who has got the might and power to handle such a grave issue. What is the possibilities of exploring the whole concept of outsourcing the entire thing to a private big organization, which will probably be more efficient and because I have seen, for example, just outside my premises, the Reliance Jio had dug up the issues for, the roads for installing their cables. But the moment the work is done, they also ensure that the road is going back to the original shape. Whereas the same work, if a BWSSB or some other BESCOM does, it remains as a pothole, and the pothole becomes a big issue. So my thought here is, I have always been a very strong supporter of the private organization.
Sure. So if I may just give you, this is a very, very important point that you've raised. And I think for the benefit of everyone to just understand, may I just take an extra 2 minutes to develop a little context around this whole thing. I'm very glad that you brought up this whole thing. One of the reasons why the city has come down on its knees is because of the monopoly that has existed in the area of SWM, where nobody else is allowed, or it's not a free market, and the best person or the most professional body is not allowed to function in the space. So while today in your mind you may be hopeful that you have someone like an industrial professional body like a Reliance or whichever other branded name that you comes to mind, that they will actually give you the services of that kind of a professional body. You have to also recognize that the government has certain frameworks. You know, you're aware of the Karnataka Transparency Act, and you cannot put that aside, that when the government puts out a tender, the requirement is that they have to keep it open for everybody, and everybody has a right to bid. But what has happened in the past is that they have come together as large, which is why the word mafia came up, right? The whole word mafia came up because they all then just simply came together as one single consortium, if you can call it, with one lead or two lead people, and all the other contractors then jumped onto it. So which means you're dealing with only one body who's providing SWM services for you in the city. They hold the city to ransom. So what they say is, if you don't accept our demands, and it's the worst kind of situation for any government to be in, that the government is then talking to someone across the table where they say, if you don't accept our demands, we will not lift waste from tomorrow. Which is why, I don't know if you recall, about 2-3 years back when we had the constant strikes and all of that, which is when the BBMP itself started recognizing that depending upon one set of people to do this whole waste management is a nightmare because they hold you to ransom. So you may have the first set of people who may be amazing guys, but since it's a process and it has to go to the Transparency Act, you cannot stop others from doing it. It's an open bid system. And you cannot stop somebody else from coming, or you cannot give a preferred mandate only to a Reliance over an XYZ contractor. The system does not exist within the government for you to do that. Therefore, the only one way that is open is an open bid system. Therefore, the alternative, which is why you also have to be aware that the court came up with the direction saying that not more than 5 wards or packages can be bid by a single individual. The entire reason was to make sure that there is no monopoly in the case in the hands of any one body or individual or company or consortium. And that has worked very well because it has just broken up that entire nexus that was happening, and which is why it's a very complex subject and has to be thought through before we take a decision to make sure that we are not getting in from the frying pan to the fire. And we have found in the past that depending on one individual or one entity does not work. Therefore, the best alternative does seem to be at this point in time that BBMP has its own in-house facilities given the complexity of this entire contracting process. I hope I convinced you on that.
Absolutely. Thanks a lot. Thank you.
Well, sir, I just want Gautam Kamath here. See, Tata company JUSCO, Jamshedpur Utility, was working with Mysore Muda for water supply and sewage supplies, maintenance. But that didn't work out. After 1 or 2 years, they walked out of the contract because of all political interference and all. Similar things happen here. As you suggested, maybe BBMP should themselves have a complete facility to do all these things. But it's a challenge with employees. How about the employees going on strike, demands not lifting? Those Indore is not facing those things?
No, they are not. And the Paurakarmikas have been working with the BBMP for the last 21,000 Paurakarmikas are working with the BBMP for the last from 2017. That's almost 2.5 years. They're working better. They're better taken care of. Their salaries have gone up, and we've not had a strike from them in that period.
I think you're saying about Indore.
Chennai Corporation had outsourced earlier, right?
Every other city has always outsourced. Chennai, Hyderabad, all the big guys, Maharashtra, every single big metro has outsourced. It's invariably been the smaller ULBs who, since they cannot afford to go in for a tender and all of that, it's the smaller ULBs which actually do the in-house management. And wherever there has been an outsourcing practice, you'll find that the waste management is not efficient. It's not effective. And the good thing is that the city stopped the tipping fee model. I mean, that was only because of the intervention of many people sitting in the expert committee, citizen expert committee, you know, where the tipping fee model was stopped. So that was one of the, so there have been a number of, you know, important strategies or decisions which have been taken over a period of time because of the involvement of citizen groups and because of advisory members who are citizens. But it still has not been enough to build the last bit, which is to manage this whole collection and transportation system, which is in the hands of the outsourced model.
Lalita here. Hi, Sandhya.
Hi.
Yeah, I had a question. See, while we talk about wet, dry, reject, and occasionally e-waste is being picked up, or we ourselves run these e-waste drives, C&D waste is something very difficult, because at household or at apartment level, when certain small constructions happen, we have no choice to throw them somewhere. Right? The last one I had asked, where for HSR layout, where do I throw it? Somewhere in the south zone, a very remote place. Why will I take my one gunny bag or two gunny bag of those? Example, I'm saying waste to such a far place, right?
Yes.
So why is there no some kind of a collection from BBMP? Either it could be a month-wise or once in 3 months, whatever it is. So there is never a collection. So where do we put that? What is the policy for that?
No, so that is the deficiency of not having a policy. You know? There is an understanding of how C&D has to be managed. There are enough papers written, enough discussions have taken place. Enough understanding is there to know how to structure this whole construction and debris management. But to implement the support, the convenience, the pickup, the processing, the recycling, to put the law on the big guys to say you have to have land banks, you have to manage like we have in situ management for apartments, the big guys, there are at least 8 or 10 requirements that have to be put into place for us to have effective construction and debris management. It comes back to the same thing. Who has thought about it? And why, you know, despite all this conversation, despite the court and everybody, there is no policy, there is no bylaw. Unless we have a policy on it, unless we have a bylaw, the officers within the system cannot pick it up and cannot set up a process or call a tender or do the next steps. The starting point is for them to have a framework. That framework is the bylaw and the policy. That does not exist. Rather, it's in the draft mode and has been in the draft mode for the last 2.5 years.
Thanks.
Hello. What is from last 2.5 years in the draft mode?
The draft policy.
Draft policy for?
The state draft policy on solid waste management, where construction and debris is also one of the components of the draft policy on how it has to be managed. So if that were to be passed, there'll be clear directions or clear guidelines to the various officers within the BBMP everywhere, on then they can budget. See, the government works like any organization, right? It has to be adopted. A policy has to be adopted. Then you can budget it. Then you can set up infrastructure. So there is a process that they have to follow. It cannot happen in an ad hoc manner. But why should it take 12, 15 years to set up a policy is what we are asking. Why should it take this much of time?
Yeah, well, it means like all these years it was in ad hoc manner. It was coming, it was doing on like some process. It was not a crisp written bylaws or guidelines, policies were not there. Now it is, draft is waiting. That's what you were saying, right?
Yes.
If you want to do anything, we have to take it forward on that line. If that is there, then everything will fall in place. Then we can speed it up. Then we, if
if we work on that, then something will happen.
Yes.
Okay. Got it.
Soumya, I think we should wrap up. It's
past. Thank you, Sandhya. If it is, sure. Do you have no further questions, anybody? Thank you so much.
Sandhya, only thing that blood is boiling with the current system. That is all we have to say. Somebody said the current politicians, most of them are only the real estate agents here and very less for the governance of the city. Somewhere the blood boils for all of us, I think, time to see some change that we want to do. So I hope something happens.
We wish you all the very best and we hope that you'll bring in good stuff into the city.
Thank you. Thanks a lot, Sita.
Thank you.